you wipe off your shoe. And you're like, what's your take on politics and the way we treat our politicians or not?
Yeah, no. But I would think to anyone, and your people putting them down and being very insulting, lots of commentators can be quite demeaning to politicians. I'd say, you know, go out and put up your posters and go knocking on doors and see the challenge that it is to get 6,000 or 7,000 votes or whatever it takes to get elected. And everyone that's in the Dáil has done that, has got elected and deserves to be there. And
do you think there's a disrespect?
I think absolutely, very much so. And it's not just a national thing, I think. And obviously, some
in the UK is the same, or US,
some of our UK guys don't appear to have done much to bolster their own good name. But it is, and it's a shame, you know, that people would choose not to go into politics, because we need people that are commercially minded. And I find that certainly when the people I deal with, you know,
to have some life experience.
Absolutely. And to understand about business. Now, of course, there's other issues as well.
Yeah.
But coming from where I'm coming, it's important to understand about business, and that construction industries have to make a profit. That's like, there won't be a business any longer, and we won't have an industry any longer. So, you know, I find that that's extremely important, that they have good background in accountancy and so on, if they're in the finance side. And otherwise, but being somebody that has a background or a family background in business certainly is a positive.
What's your take on political parties? When you and I were growing up, you know, there was a 2.5 party system, Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael, and the Labour Party. That has utterly changed now. You know, in rural Ireland, a lot of rural independents. Sinn Féin are certainly on the march, over 30%, and so on. Do you think, like in a lot of them, that the old Civil War politics is finished, or what's your sense of where that's going to end up?
Well, look, I suppose what happened in Ireland has happened globally as well. I think we've seen that fragmentation across Europe. And I suppose our two main parties were, you know, there because of the Civil War. Very little
similar ideology.
Yeah, same ideology. Labour Party, you know, it's a Labour Party in every country. The PDs, I suppose, you know, did find a niche. They got sort of blown away. Lots of people.
It's very hard for a new party to sustain itself, isn't it?
Absolutely, and we've seen, you know, very few of them. Sinn Féin now seem to be, you know, in the ascendancy. Weekend polls show that they're after taking a bit of a hit. So look, it's easy for an opposition party, as you know, you can be very political.
You can't be blamed for anything. Yeah,
and you can take a very populist view, and you can be very critical.
But is your sense of it that we are on the cusp of a very significant historical change?
Yeah, well, I think like has happened in Europe as well, you could have multi-party governments. You know, I think Belgium found it almost impossible to form a government for a long period. So that's likely. Then we saw some changes in Holland lately, where an opposition group to anti-farmer, and being overly protective. A lot of people got elected and so on. So, you know, we are in very strange times. But I would hope that we continue to attract good people into politics.
Now, the construction industry has had its ups and downs. You had to deal with the crash. You've had to deal with the demonization of developers. And there was a lot of people had a lot of pain in terms of losing their homes and so on. What's the current state of the construction industry?
Well, I'd say pretty healthy. The value is up against about 32 to 34 billion. It's not far off of where it was at the peak before we had the crash. I suppose you could say that's a slight worry. But inward investment is very strong here. And I think the presence of the big techie, the global tech firms, the likes of the Amazons, the Intels, the Metas and so on, the standards that they've raised for Irish contractors in building out their projects here, and then our Irish contractors on the ground to it, that's certainly lifted. The technology take up amongst our contractors is very good. The housing scarcity, you know, everyone says we need between 30 and 50,000 houses each year for the next 10 years. That's going to take a lot of people and a lot of industry people to deliver that. And clearly,
my own view is that, you know, we have a housing crisis, but we have a planning emergency, huge shortages of staff at local authority and board level, judicial reviews, you know, just out of town, possibly, you know, Irish Water, you know, they go through planning, then they've got to go through a 2-year consent process afterwards. I mean, like, I kind of think that the body politic doesn't get it, that like our planning system is choking, that there's an objector culture that is not being confronted. Is all that wrong?
No, I think you're spot on. I mean, I think I saw someone saying over the weekend that, you know, if you set out to build houses on a green field, it's a monumental project that you take on. Because from the very first day, if everybody's against it. Now, I expect that when a foreign direct investor comes in here, he has a good welcome from the IDA and he introduces them to the different ones. And there's an open welcome. Now, the day you go building houses, you're appear to be up against it all along. And as you said, planning is mad. Like, you know,
like, there is no shortage of money. The government is throwing money. Like, in fact, they underspend about $1 billion a year on housing allocation.
Yeah.
So money isn't the problem.
Yeah.
Planning or maybe staff shortages?
Planning, lack of zoned land. When land is zoned for housing, that should nearly give it the green light that housing should go along there. But then, obviously, local residents object. And as you mentioned there earlier, this judicial review is crazy now. Anybody with an axe to grind can seek a judicial review. Judiciary seem to be experts in planning now as well, in holding it up.
Any regrets?
No, not really. Like, I think the opportunities that I got in my life, and I was very lucky to be reared by parents that gave me a great work ethic, worked very hard. I was a farmer for 50 years.
There's nothing you did that you say, geez, if I had it again, I wouldn't do that.
Yeah, look, I'm not going to lose any sleep over that.
You're not going to admit it either. Okay. What would you advise your 18-year-old self? From, you know, you've been around the block. What would you advise your 18-year-old self?
Well, I was just saying to the students, I had to say a few closing remarks down in Mount Bellew, that I finished my formal education in Bertine College, where I think
I did
my year there, my ag year, and I went into the world of agricultural contracting and farming. I picked up my life skills, so I think the way we're going forward.
Constant
now,
upskilling and learning, would that be advice?
Absolutely. I think, like, CIF's big role for people is training and upskilling, and you need that every day now. Solus is obviously a commercial player and so on, but, like, things are changing. Stuff that was in vogue 2 years ago or 4 years ago isn't anymore, so I think constant lifelong learning and upskilling, I think, is going to be the way we go forward.
All right, there's a bit of a hoolie for Tom on Thursday night. I hope to go to it in around the construction house. I want to thank you for your service. I think you've given exceptional service to the private sector, and you've been a voice of one thing that's really lacking: common sense. You've always had lots of Tom Martin. We wish you well as you face into your transition to change. All right, now it's time for this.
Your chance to win big.
News Talks, Summer Cash Machine.
Okay, another big winner last week. We've given away 2.6 million this year, 68 different winners, but it's relocated. Now, if you get in touch after 3 p.m. today, you'll get a call back. The number you need to know is €10,311.90. 10,311.90. Text the word play to the number 57557. Just the word play, and you could get that call back. And answer within 5 rings, or if you miss out, you lose. All right, now lots more. Coming up, we're going to have Sarah Madden with a News Talk report on how we can prevent the ever-increasing surge in diabetes. And all the different holiday treats, from fat bikes in Connemara to new terraces. Paula Canila will be with us.
The Pat Kenny Show on News Talk.
With Aviva Insurance. You'll hear great quotes on the show, but you can find even better ones on aviva.ie.
Take a deep breath. Reach for your headphones. Choose the News Talk app and tune in.
Kieran Clay is tune out.
This is News Talk.
You are listening to the Hard Show. Kieran Cuddihy with you until 7 o'clock.
The Loftus Committee have indicated that they're going to write to her anyway.
How often did you change your sheets when you were in college?
A whole term when I changed my sheets.
Oh, I'm leaving now. Hi.
What actually are you prepared to compromise on if there is a new Ireland?
The Hard Shoulder
with Nissan.
Weekdays from 4 on News Talk. Conversation that counts.
The future is yours for the taking. When you become one of the 8,000 students across the island of Ireland studying with the Open University, join the experts in distance learning on one of many internationally recognized degrees and skills-based short courses. And suddenly, your options are thrown wide open. Search OU Ireland to find out more. The Open University. The future is open.
Don't waste time. Have your say on the National Waste Management Plan. This plan, by the local authorities of Ireland, sets out a path for our natural resources, increase reuse, repair, and recycling, and promote sustainable growth. We want your view on Ireland's plans. Go to mywaste.ie.
With soaring energy costs, there's never been a better time to install an Energlaze solar electric system from Wallway. It will help power your home with clean, green, renewable energy, dramatically reduce energy bills and your carbon footprint. Future-proof your home with the power of Wallway Fusion Solar from Energlaze. And now you can save even more with up to €2,400 in grants, zero VAT, and you can get paid for any extra electricity you don't use. Take the first step today. Visit Energlaze.ie towards a greener, warmer home every step of the way.
Ishka Éireann is the new name for Irish water. Our continued focus is to deliver clean, safe, and reliable national public drinking water and wastewater services for Ireland. For any questions about public water services or to report an issue in your area, call us 24 hours a day, 7 days a week on 1-800-278-278 or visit water.ie. Ishka Éireann. Delivering water services for Ireland. Terrence and Calvin bring their award-winning chart-topping podcast to the National Stadium in Dublin. This coming June 28th and 29th. Join the lads for a night of comedy, crack, live music and more. Special guests on the night include sex educator Jenny Keane and comedian Willow White, with some big surprise guests on the night. This is going to be another special show you don't want to miss. Tickets are on sale now from Ticketmaster. Go to present Talking Live, an unmissable entertainment experience.
Aviva Insurance. You've been with the show since 9. We've been with you since 1780, providing great value insurance.
This is News Talk.
I've been filling in for Pat all this week. One texter puts it bluntly. Just build the houses and stop giving us reasons not to. Never mind RTE.
Travel on the Pat Kenny Show.
Thanks to Ryanair. Flying you to over 200 destinations is our business. What you do there is yours.
Now, I'm delighted to welcome Paul O'Connella, the Irish Independent Traveller editor, and without doubt, the hardest working travel editor anywhere. Do you have an Instagram account? I'd say every photograph you put up, there's not if a cat urinates, you know about it when it comes to travel. Now, today we're going to talk about things to do. So you're staying in Ireland and you're going to a particular area and you've got the self-catering or staying in a hotel or whatever it might be, things to do. Let's start with the eastern side of the country, the Green Garden of Wicklow and Kilkenny.
Yeah, so I wanted to look at stuff that's new and exciting and you might have heard before, and if you're like us, this is kind of the time of the summer where the kids start saying, I'm bored, or what'll I do today? So a couple of ideas for you. Did you know that Avondale got a huge revamp last year?
That's now the Parnell place.
Yes. So just a couple of weeks ago, it opened Parnell's old home to tours, but the main draw for kids and that is it has Ireland's highest slide. You go up this giant pint-shaped wooden structure in the woods, you get into the tunnel at the top, and you boosh around in a spiral of 90 metres all the way to the bottom. They've also added a tree canopy walk that's fully accessible, so everybody can access that. It takes you up and you walk along this wooden platform up in the tree canopy, so it's brilliant crack.
It sounds all dangerous, and you've another zipline experience in Castlecomer.
Not at all dangerous. The Castlecomer one is added this summer, and if you know Castlecomer Discovery Park, it's a brilliant not-for-profit outdoors attraction in Castlecomer. There are walks, there's a craft charge, there's archery you can do, there's zip lines, there's kayaking. So new this year, they have a high ropes course that has zip lines, and one of the things on it, you harness in and you can do an 11 meter free fall at the end. So that's literally where you stand off the platform. You have a rope attached to you and you fall down. Now, it lets you land gently, there's kind of a spring attached to it. And they're pitching that as a half day activity, but you can get around it in about 2 hours and it's €25 per person.
All right. Now, what is a velo rail?
A velo rail, in this case, is a new tourist attraction in Kilchimock, County Mayo. And basically what's happened here is you've heard
that's
about
where Louis Walsh comes from.
Is it?
Yeah. I once did Celebrity Banish Tour, and that used to be Ryan Tuberty's old partner. I know her very well, she's in UCD. Basically, she beat me from the Kilchimock team. We were leading by 2 points, and they got a goal in extra time. It nearly killed me. So what is a velo rail?
Well, you can challenge a return match here on the velo rail. They basically have rebooted an old railway line. that was disused. So similar to the Great Western Greenway, which was an out-of-use railway line between Westport and Apple. Here is a 7 kilometer stretch where they've put these carts on with the railway style wheels, and you sit in under a cover, but they can seat up to 5 people, and you pedal. And you go out from
you only go as fast as you pedal.
You have to do a bit of work, so I would load it up with people who are prepared to carry you along if that's your attitude.
Okay. Now, the Guinness Storehouse is the most single popular tourist resort and most visited in the country.
Yeah.
What are they doing new?
It's €26 to get in, by the way, so it's not cheap, but they are, one thing I do like about what they're doing is they're constantly sort of running the creative rule over it. It's always been sort of a brand thing for Guinness with psychedelic, as you know. So the storehouse this summer, if you go along, you will see an indoor beach and park installations.
And then why would you want an indoor beach? The whole point is that the sea and the potential of sunshine.
Occasionally you need to occasionally. But you do get a free pint, I think, at the end of it.
At
the rooftop bar, and they're
spectacular view of the city.
It's amazing. They're holding gigs up there as well. There's one other one in Dundrum Airfield, the urban farm. Are you familiar with that? I know you were talking about farming earlier, but it is just a brilliant educational day out for kids.
What, is it digging in the soil?
It's an immersive exhibition, so you will literally enter a tunnel with the displays and learning about the composition of soil and why it's good for us, and you enter below ground into this dome where you're now looking up into the layers of soil. You can see literally the different strata, what it's made of, the worms, the bugs that live there. You learn all about it. Most of us don't.
Now, for guys like you that are a bit literary, what's this decanting Trinity's old library?
Well, I hadn't been into the old library for ages. I went in a couple of weeks ago and I saw people in there with purple gloves on and miniature vacuums and carts delicately removing the old tomes from the shelves, one by one, with these tiny little whispery vacuums, and putting them away in catalogue storage, because this autumn it's going to close for 3 years for an enormous renovation. As we saw with Notre Dame in Paris, these old buildings really need to be kept up to spec. So if you go now, you'll not only get to see the book of cells, but you get to see this process happening. And they've got some screens erected within the alcoves that show you how the books are being carried and all that. So it's going to be unique. You go in there and it's like being in Hogwarts, or it was used famously, I think, as an inspiration for the Jedi archive and Star Wars and all that. So that's there. And then in autumn, that's going to move into a big temporary accommodation. That'll cost you $18.50 for the Book of Kells and the library.
What's a blue way?
A blue way is like a green way, except it's near or on water. So it could be a canal, could be a lake, could be a river. I'll give you a couple of examples. One of them, you might have heard of the floating boardwalk near Drumshambo in County Leitrim. There's also a canal that connects the river with Acres Lake. And the idea is that when blue ways are designated, there is our facilities are built along the walkways, cycleways, and local companies can add in with kayaking trips or with stand-up paddling and so on. And I took a stand-up paddling trip on close to Acres Lake with Leitrim Surf a couple of years ago, and it was absolutely remote. The trees coming in over our heads, and the guy that was leading me along said, "This is the Drumshamazon."
Now, dinosaurs in Kilkenny. What's this, Bobby Kerr or Brian Cody? What are the dinosaurs in
there? These are, in actual fact, life-size animatronic dinosaurs. So,
rather than animatronic,
it means it moves and it makes noise. And it is a...
it's a replica dinosaur.
Yeah. If you have in your family or extended family kids 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and you watch them go around in their dinosaur jammies and hats and all that, and you know why this is popular. Basically, the Flynn family that own Hotel New Park down there had this idea, this madcap idea a year ago, to build what they're calling Jurassic New Park, and there is a life-size T-Rex, a Brachiosaurus, Velociraptors, and so on.
I might be adding to the pub straight away. Alright, now what's down by the seaside? A new saunas by the seaside in Donegal.
What do you think about this one?
It's not just like a hot tub experience.
It's like, no, a picture. Oh, how do I sell this to you? Because I know the pub is very competitive. Picture a container with a floor ceiling glass end at the end and a sauna inside. And it's like a pop-up sauna, let's say. It's a temporary structure, and it's positioned within a run or a short walk up the sea. And it's not just the sea. I was at, well, I was,
but how do you stop the hot air escaping?
Well, you open, like in any sauna, when you open the door, a bit of it gets out. Okay. You have to close it nice and quick, and you have to get down and do your ablutions in the sea. But it's not just this. I was at, I passed one by in Greystones County Wicklow recently at Rise of the Cove. There's another one at Banagher Marina by the Shannon, which is there on the weekend. So it is a growing thing. And when I first heard of it, I thought, God, hipster craziness.
Well, we're getting tight on time. But it is, you have a few other seaside treats.
There's a few other bits. Watch out for the new National Surf Centre. That's a big deal in Strand Hill. So if you know Strand Hill, great surfing mecca. But that's the first state-of-the-art surfing facility in Ireland. So they do lessons and you can get all
what
the kit
is a fat bike, Paul?
Okay, I'm trying. Will this one get you?
They just make wheels.
Yeah.
No, right.
Yeah.
That's also, it's all nearly knocked me over.
Some of them can be electric as well.
They're kind of electric, yeah.
Yeah, so if you get one that's electric, it means...
Like it's about like a 4-inch wheel on it. Is that right?
Yeah, they're really huge. They're like kind of Hummers bikes or something. But anyway,
should we ban them? I don't.
Why have them? Because you can go over loose gravel and snow, and you can go up paths and mountains and things that you wouldn't be able to on a normal bike, and particularly if you have the e-motor. So there's a couple you can do. There's Belmont Bike Firm, I don't know if you know it, in Wicklow. It's brilliant. And this is to your point about should they be banned or not. No, because these are off-road and they're on dedicated tracks. And there's another lad, Martin Branley, Fat Bike Galway, who's doing tours of Connemara on electric fat bikes.
Well, completely.
Now you've heard it all.
Oh, I have. Paula Canila, as I told you, Irish Independent Travel Editor. Your appetite has been whetted. All sorts of lovely things. Thank you, as always. Sarah Matton, News Talks reporter, is now going to give us a report in relation to diabetes. Why? Well, diabetes cases are growing aggressively in every country, particularly over the next 30 years. A recent research that says 1 in 10 of us will have the disease by 2050. So, is Ireland prepared for this influx of diabetes, and what will we have to pay for our health? Here's Sarah's report.
According to The Lancet, there will be more than 1 billion diabetics worldwide by 2050.
When you hear the word diabetes, it normally is referring to type 2, because type 2 is 90% of cases.
For some, the diagnosis will be shocking. A long sentence. But for others, it may mean big business.
Well, I actually call this a scam. I actually think this is a corruption.
So what is this disease? Why is it on the rise? And can the HSE handle the diabetic tidal wave approaching?
So when you actually pinch between your fingers the rolls, you know, those Michelin rolls that we talk about around your tummy, that's actually subcutaneous fat.
Dr. Eva Orsmond is the medical director of Orsmond Clinics and author of Reverse Your Diabetes.
So the rolls around your tummy are actually reflecting what's deep inside that you can't see and you can't touch. And that visceral fat is where the diabetes lives, because that deep fat produces inflammatory compounds. That's where the insulin resistance lives.
To try to counteract this insulin resistance, the body will produce more of it, with wide and complex consequences.
Type 2 diabetes affects every single part of the body, because obviously the high sugar readings are basically damaging slowly, silently, without knowing your neurological system, your cardiovascular, because many people find themselves that they're diabetic when they wake up in ICU after heart attack, eyesight, chronic aches and pains, you know, ulcers and amputations.
645 people with diabetes underwent a lower limb amputation in 2021, accounting for almost 70% of all such procedures carried out in Ireland that year.
We used to call this middle age disease, so it was typically those mid-50s, 60-year-old who used to get this disease. Now it's younger and younger and younger, and that's for the fact that we are putting more and more age in the middle. The problem is silent. It takes, often we say, 7 years from the start to the diagnosis. So those 7 years when you don't know you have the disease, you're already silently creating the damage.
Derek O'Keefe is the HSE National Clinical Lead for Diabetes.
We estimate there's about 500 million people with diabetes. By 2050, it might be upwards at 1.3 billion, which is, you know, a mind-boggling number when you can think of the population of the planet is going to be about 7 or 8 billion, so it'll be about 1 in 10 people, which is just a phenomenally prevalent disease in our society.
Of the HSE's 16 billion 2019 budget, 1.6 billion is diabetes.
10% of the 16 billion budget is a significant amount of the budget. And it's not just for the prevention of it or the care of it, it's for all the complications. If that number jumps from 6%, which is the current prevalence, to the projected, you know, 15-20%, which is what the Lancet paper suggests, that means the budget needed to treat it would essentially triple in the next 30 years.
Diabetes is outpacing most diseases globally, presenting a significant threat to people and our health systems. Though Derek says the HSE is not without a plan.
There's some really great people working in the HSE. We can all see the horizon of what's coming with diabetes, both here in Ireland and obviously globally. We have actual diabetes prevention programs to intervene when people, for example, have pre-diabetes and try and prevent its onset. We obviously have structured patient education, so that if you do have diabetes and you've developed it, we can teach you about that really important health, the lifestyle part. There's better and better medications coming out to keep people's blood sugar in the right target. And we're developing tools such as registries now, so that we can, you know, see and track the disease as it evolves. There's a new enhanced community care scheme being rolled out in Ireland, whereby for every 150,000 people, there will be a ECC hub specializing in the three main chronic diseases in Ireland, which is diabetes, heart failure, and COPD. And so for diabetes care in your local community, you will have a endocrinology consultant, you know, specializing in type 2 diabetes, clinical nurse specialist in diabetes, podiatrist in diabetes, and you'll have dietitians in diabetes, all working together as part of an MDM team in the community. And that has actually started in diabetes since January of this year, and we hope over the next 2 years to get up to 25 hubs up and running around the country. And that's a remarkable investment and, you know, forward strategical thinking by the government to try and ameliorate this tsunami that's coming over the next 30 years.
I've seen some people, unfortunately, with the disease who haven't kept it under control, who've had leg amputations. I think I was pretty worried about the kidney disease, you know, nervous system, other frightening thoughts, yes.
Mother of two, Yvonne, was first diagnosed with diabetes at the age of 31.
I suppose 7 years ago I was diagnosed, almost 8 years ago now, with diabetes. The information that I received off my doctor was to go straight on medication. It was not to challenge myself to lose weight, to eat better, be put forward towards a dietitian. It was, the answer was always medication.
Dr. Eva again.
The drug treatment is obviously in a way getting more effective, so people's sugar readings are coming down, but there's a huge amount of side effects that comes with those drugs. So of course they have to be treated. And you know yourself, when you're actually treating a symptom and not the cause, you know that you're not at the right track, because as doctors we were taught at the university that we should actually treat the cause, not the symptom, and at the moment we are treating the symptom.
Derek thinks Dr. Eva's assessment is unfair.
So what I would say is every doctor, when they speak with their patient, they talk about the fundamental basis of the pyramid or the foundation, healthy lifestyle. So you need to eat well and you need to exercise to keep your body healthy throughout your life. But unfortunately, that people's choices or in some cases their socioeconomic status, they're not able to make good choices. And therefore you do need to use medication to help them, you know, keep their blood sugars in the correct range.
For Yvonne though, lifelong medication seemed more like a life sentence than a lifeline. So she decided to visit Dr. Ava's diabetes clinic earlier this year.
I think I first went in January because I was feeling exceptionally tired. I also had stopped having a menstrual cycle. Yeah, it was hard, but I needed to do it. I was in the right mind frame to do it, as opposed to going on more medication. That was huge for me, was not to be put on more medication.
I put Yvonne on a low carbohydrate diet, very monitored, based on a lot of vegetables. She needs to do a lot of home cooking, and we give her certain supplements which are lower in carbohydrates, but still that she gets all the vitamins and minerals. She basically now, within 3 months, I haven't actually had a chance to tell her the good news yet, but I'm actually, if she allows me, I'm actually going to reveal the news to her that she's actually reversed her diabetes, her HbA1c when she was 39 at your last results. Considering that I think it's over 90 your head. So congratulations.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic news. But she's only after sharing with me now, so yes. I'll go home and shed some tears later.
If the tide of diabetes can be stemmed by anything, Dr. Eva says it will be education.
We should empower diabetic patients to know about the disease, how to deal with it, and actually understand the side effects. Because type 2 diabetes, 15 years of life expectancy. And nowadays, the life expectancy is improving thanks to the drugs, but the quality of type 2 diabetic lives is not that great, with the pains and aches and the consequences that the diabetes bring. So I think the first approach is that we need to actually start with the lifestyle change, and that, as stated by International Diabetes Federation, we should give people 3 to 6 months choice when they're newly diagnosed, you know, in a controlled, in a supportive environment, to actually help them to do the lifestyle change, not just hand them the pill for every ill approach, which is making millions for pharmaceuticals and just putting more and more money in consultation fees for private hospital. Sorry, this is a hard word, but this is the reality. This disease is totally controllable for 98% of the cases, and let's after that put that money, what is saved, in where it's actually needed.
Yeah, time to pay attention. 1 in 10 of us to get diabetes. It is preventable, and therefore, a great report there from Sarah Madden. Thank you. Well, a vision has appeared in front of me. It's Andrea Gilligan.
How are you?
These Ryan's pay in the halfpenny box. That's
to be a fine thing.
So,
what are you keeping?
Great form. Now, I was listening to you last week, €900 a night for Taylor's and all that kind of thing. So, what are you going to start an argument about today?
Would you, your opportunity to move to Arranmore, I know your great love of all things Donegal.
Okay.
Would you go? Remote island.
You're going to pay me what? €80,000 to go?
80,000 to buy a property in. On Arranmore, also off Clare Island as well, off the coast of Mayo. It's all part of the government's Arranmore Islands.
I don't want you to clear off people off of the islands. No, we want you to. You have to run electricity.
Yeah, no, we want to improve services. So
this is
you could have a nice
money.
Little retirement.
Taxpayer money.
Retirement home for Ivan of Arranmore.
The lines will be open from
53106. I want to know what it's like to live on an island and are people game.
All right, looking forward to that. Lunchtime Live coming up. Up next, our expert, resident expert today, we're going to lawyer up again. We're going to have Julie Galbraith to talk about legal advice. Are you entitled to work from home? What's the story about the statutory sick pay? Still coming up.
The Pat Kenny Show on News Talk.
With Aviva Insurance. Pat keeps you company when getting from A to B, and we'll keep you covered. Aviva Insurance Ireland DAC is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Get the gang together for the party of the year. Pull on your leg warmers, crimp your hair, and go back to the 80s at Forever Young Festival, featuring Squeeze, Panorama, ABC, Billy Ocean, Tony Hadley, Soul to Soul, Vidure,
Go West,
Jason Donovan,
Cutting Crew,
China Crisis,
Hot House Flowers,
Cry Before Dawn,
Tom Zone,
La Mange, and many, many more.
July 14th to 16th, 2023.
Tickets from €79 on sale now.
Booking fees apply.
ForeverYoungFestival.ie.
Make it a summer to really remember with Go Breaks. From family getaways to romantic hideaways, discover our best hotel deals now at GoBreaks.ie.
Go Breaks.
The moment you got told the good news.
Rob, you made the panel.
When the lads added you into the group. Skipping nights out, missing the crack. Rewatching classics and learning new tricks. Being driven to the biggest game of your life by your man. Then you finally come on in the 51st minute. It's the minor moments that last a lifetime. The Electric Ireland GAA Minor Championships. This is major.
You're at the counter in your local shop. Birthday card in one hand, a pack of those teeny tiny candles in the other. Now for a present. Only to look up and see the display of scratch cards. Talk about the best present ever if they win big. Birthday or no birthday, with millions in cash prizes to be won instantly, next time you're in store, ask for any all-cash scratch card. The National Lottery. It could be them. Gift responsibly.
What does it take to be the best? A healthy, balanced diet and active lifestyle is a great way to start. John West Tuna is naturally high in protein and vitamin D, supporting the development and maintenance of muscles. And speaking of support, John West is proud to once again sponsor Fela Perra Nook and Fela Linnail. We'll be supporting all the under-15s playing at Fela this June and July. John West. Eat strong, go strong, train strong.
The Pat Kenny Show.
Fela Insurance. A better deal on car and home insurance isn't a matter of opinion. Fela Insurance Ireland DAC is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
This is News Talk.
And
delighted to be joined with our resident expert today, Julie Galbraith, partner in employment law at the global firm of Evershed's Sutherland. Julie, you're welcome. I want to ask you about the place to work from home. Either their employer says, no, I want you back in the office Monday to Friday, or a worker says, look, I just don't want to commute from Marlow to Dublin. What is the legal position?
Thanks for having me, Ivan. I think we all were surprised in 2020 when we all moved so quickly to work from home. In hindsight, that was the easy part. The easy part was pulling down the shutters, giving everyone a laptop or an iPad or a phone, and getting everyone up to speed and working away. The really hard part is getting people back in a consistent way that works for both the employer and the employee. We've had so many returns to the office, returns to work phases, that brought people back in so many different ways. We had desk spacing, we had masks, we had rules around not being able to ask about vaccine status and work. We've been through so much, but now we're at the point that there's new legislation which was enacted in March of this year, and it's all around the work-life balance and the miscellaneous provisions bill, which set out a right to request flexible working. Now it's just a right. Within that,
a right to request as opposed to a right to obtain.
Correct. And within that, the WRC are currently working on a code of practice which will enable employers and employees to follow that process. The legislation as it stands purely sets out the right. It doesn't give any recourse to an employee if that right is or that request is refused, which means that, to use your example, someone living in Ireland wanted to come and work in Dublin, they say, this just simply doesn't work for me. I'm working so well from home. I am so productive. There are no issues with my work balance at all.
I'm suspicious on a Friday. They're going for a walk at 4 o'clock, they're getting in a round of golf, they're catching up on their Netflix, they're doing a bit of parenting, but they're not working for me. And I'm going to say, Mary, I want you in the office on Friday. Can I insist on that?
You can. So most contracts of employment in Ireland will have the office as the place of work. So for any employee listening, it's only the third or the fourth clause in your contract, which is called place of work. That will say your place of work is at Macroney House, Dublin 2, or Earlsford Terrace, Dublin 2, where our offices are. There has been a facilitation of working from home for the last 3 years, but that's not a right. So to use your example, yes, you don't absolutely require people to come back. But on the reverse, we are seeing a huge challenge about recruiting and retaining
staff. Staff shortages, yeah.
So you're not going to get
married. It's an employee's market.
Absolutely. So most of the clients that we work with at the moment are those that are in customer-facing roles are entirely different. But those who are in office roles, professional services, all of that, we will see people coming back 2 to 3 days a week. And that's quite consistent across the board. I don't see anyone working.
See, forgive me, I'm old school, I'm cynical, but I'm hearing now the nightclubs and the late bars are all really busy on a Thursday night. And methinks they won't be working their ass off on Friday. Am I old-fashioned?
No, I hear the same about Thursday evenings. That certainly is there.
And that's in London as well as Dublin.
Entirely. The issue there is not really a work-life balance working from home issue, that's a performance issue. So if the employer has issues with performance on a Friday, they have to deal with that through their performance process. They can't deal with that and apply it across the board to all the people who are working well from home and require that everyone now comes in on a Friday. That's not the right nut to crack with a hammer there.
So you have a legal right to request it, but that's about it.
Yeah, and what I'd say to employers is that you have to look at your policies and you have to look at your own business. So how will it work for your business if employees start working from home? How many employees can you facilitate? Do you have a lot of employees who already, for care and responsibilities, are working from home? You're going to have a headache, for want of a better word, when so many of your employees with families are now working from home, and other employees without families are saying, I want to work from home too. So consider across the board, how many can you facilitate? Do you do that on a phase basis? Do you do that on a rota? Try and do it that all employees get this right. The law as it stands allows employees to take a claim if the process hasn't been followed. So an employer must respond within 4 weeks of the request been made with reasons. So that's the only recourse that an employee currently has, the WRC, is if the employer hasn't responded within 4 weeks and hasn't given reasons. If an employer has a good analyzed this and has thought through what they need to do, then they're likely to be okay depending on what the WRC code of practice says.
The other thing I wanted to ask you about briefly is the statutory sick pay scheme that came in January. How does it work?
Well, a lot of employees now are much more knowledgeable in terms of the benefits that are coming through for them. In January of this year, the government announced a statutory sick pay scheme, and this again came through as a result of COVID. So you might remember back to the meat packing plants. There were so many employees saying that they had no entitlement to paid sick pay and they had to come to work, regardless of the fact that they were unwell. Ireland has been an outlier in Europe for a long time. We didn't have employer-paid sick pay. We've always had state-paid sick pay, but that generally doesn't come in until after day three. So currently, as things stand, employees have a right to 3 days paid sick pay from their employer. That kicks in after 13 weeks, and they, under the legislation, must give a doctor cert from day one. So this is a little bit counterintuitive for some employees. You can get a maximum of up to €80, depending on how much you're paying yourself. So the problem here is the doctor's cert can often cost €50 or €60. Sorry, it's maximum up to €110, but it's up to 70% of an employee's own pay package.
Well, what if 70% was more than €110?
Well, you'll only get €110.
Right.
So you have to offset the €60 or €50 for your doctor's cert and your €110. Now, many employers will have much more flexible and more beneficial schemes where they might pay for up to 6 months.
So this would be a minimum baseline?
Correct, minimum baseline.
All right. And in all circumstances, you can't just say, look, I'm not able to come in, I've got the flu or whatever, but I don't need to go to the doctor, that won't work. You have to have a doctor, sir?
No, most employers' sick pay schemes or sick policies would say that they kick in after day three. So now the government is saying this kicks in on day one, but the legislation also says you have to provide a sick cert. So it's not as helpful as it could be maybe for employees who don't want the bother of going to the doctor every day that they're sick.
Julie Galbraith, partner in employment law at the global firm Eversheds Sutherland's, thank you for being our resident expert today. A reminder that our items from today are uploaded as podcasts, which you can listen to on the News Talk app powered by Go Loud. Just search for the Pat Kenny Show. My thanks to all the team helping me out today.